Well, thank you, John, for that wonderful introduction, and I'll thank you on behalf of my colleagues who are also, I have to say, as members of the Board of Directors of the Association of Universities, my bosses, all three of them, and Jerry is the chairman of our organization. So these are people that are very important in my life as well. It's very a great pleasure for me to be here tonight at NYU, and I now can claim to be an alum, and so I'm delighted to be a part of this. I thought that I would talk briefly a little bit about the history of American universities and their relationship with cities. I'm a little bit intimidated because I see Jonathan Cole in the audience, who's just written a magisterial book about the American research universities, and he knows more than anyone, I think, about the history and the life of American universities. But I would try to set the stage here tonight for the discussion without going into war stories about relationships with the local communities and universities that I've been a part of. And I suspect maybe my colleagues will add some of the experiences that they've had, but try to set the stage more with a bit of an historical point of reference, because I think throughout their history until quite recently, most American universities have by and large not been closely linked to the development of cities. The settlement and growth of cities along the Eastern Seaboard, of course, brought with it the creation of King's College, which became Columbia here in New York, the Academy of Philadelphia, which became the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, and in the early years of the Republic, of course, the founding of NYU by Albert Gallatin, again, here in New York City. But most of the early colleges were located in small rural communities. Probably taking their model from Oxford and Cambridge, after which, of course, the city in which Harvard was located was also named. And as the nation spread westward, the state universities, like nearly all of the new liberal arts colleges that were also created in the early 19th century, were located in small towns and far away from major cities. And when you think about it, it's Ann Arbor, not Detroit. It's Champaign-Urbana, not Chicago. It's Bloomington, not Indianapolis. And the list could go on, including, indeed, Berkeley instead of San Francisco or Oakland. And there are many reasons for locating universities in small towns at a distance from cities. In most cases, there was a bidding war that went on. And the towns offered up land or money or a building of an educational establishment with an existing school, or the location, so the location simply went to the biggest bidder, and towns competed for universities in the way they competed for railroads, recognizing the kind of synergy that would come from having both a university and a railroad through their town. In some states, they were distributed like other public goods, simply around the state by a political process. The penitentiary went in one place, the insane asylum, as it was called then, went in another place, and the university in a third. With the passage of the Morrill Act establishing land-grant universities, that also obviously encouraged the location of universities in rural communities where the land for experimental plots was readily available. Of the early land-grant universities, only Minnesota established its university in the population center. But the location of universities in small towns also reflected a basic American Jeffersonian antipathy for cities. Jefferson's views of cities as pestilent to the morals, the health, and the liberties of man, as he said, was widely shared by many early educators and contributed to the bias for locating colleges in rural settings. Crowded, noisy, unclean, corrupt, Cities were considered antithetical to scholarly thought. They were filled with distractions and unsuitable places for young people. And this helped form the notion of the university as an ivory tower, remote from the gritty realities of the world. And for students drawn largely from the middle class, the 4 years of college were seen as a kind of time out from the real world and from ordinary cares and work, and a time for learning and maturity, to be sure, but also a relatively carefree period which was safer in a small rural community. Neither the public universities built in the 19th century nor the older private elite universities effectively served American cities initially. Both Columbia and Penn moved away from downtown centers early in the 19th century and were once again enveloped by their cities in the early 20th century. Excuse me, but they were not predominantly local institutions initially. After World War II, for example, Penn effectively closed itself off from its city surroundings, making it, in the words of its plan, a community of scholars residing in and around a campus closed off to vehicular traffic, unlike the NYU that John described. The colleges and universities founded to serve urban populations were largely sectarian, predominantly established by the Catholic Church, intended to serve heavily Catholic immigrant populations at the time. Not until the surge of enrollments and the demand for access to higher education in the 1960s, could you hand me a glass of water? I've got a kind of a bad throat. Not until the 1960s did we see universities beginning to turn their attention toward cities. The civil rights movement of the 60s forced universities to recognize how little they had served the cities and their minority populations. The arrival of the baby boomer generation at college led to a demand for broader access. The Great Society expanded federal support for college attendance. Sputnik spurred investment in research, and the National Defense Education Act added funding for graduate students. The expansion of higher education during the 1960s produced a lot of proposals, including one by Clark Kerr, the former president of Berkeley, or of the University of California, who had designed the growth of the University of California system. He proposed the creation of 67 urban grant universities that would be federal universities applied for by private and public institutions and located in the major cities. Every city over 250,000, he believed, should have such an urban grant university. The importance of the university in the welfare of the nation and the economic growth of the nation had been recognized certainly since the Second World War. But the primary justification for universities in cities was not economic development. It was advancing the public good by broadening human capacity, especially among the urban underclass. To the extent that urban universities were considered catalysts for economic development, it was not through innovation and the creation of new technology as we tend to see them today, but as agents of urban renewal, restoring and building neighborhoods. It was less that universities created new jobs than that they provided jobs. Many became the largest employers in their regions. The emergence of high technology companies in the 1970s, with some spawned by universities and all dependent in some sense on ideas and graduates, universities themselves helped produce metropolitan areas, attracting industry and an educated population. Some concentrations of technology firms, such as those that gathered on Route 128 near Boston, were inspired by Harvard and by MIT, but other metropolitan universities or areas grew out of the rural settings and the proximity of major universities. Stanford, for example, still refers to its campus as the farm, but it's no longer a bucolic rural setting because it's surrounded by the rapid growth of a metropolitan area with its scores of high-tech companies in Silicon Valley. While nothing on the scale of Silicon Valley developed elsewhere, similar symbioses between research universities and tech firms developed in the Research Triangle in North Carolina and Austin, Texas, and other places. While these are not typically urban universities, their metropolitan settings caused them increasingly to resemble recently developed urban universities with their concentrations of educated people and the social and cultural life of the regions that they helped carry. Like urban universities, these research-intensive universities also became more frequently embroiled in conflicts with their local communities. Perceived as wealthy, somewhat insular, and privileged, often immune from local jurisdictions with their tax-exempt status, removing larger portions of the landscape from the tax rolls, universities often found themselves in conflict with the very communities they have helped develop. The growing concentration of universities and industry after the Bayh-Dole Act emphasized universities in terms of the economic development that they provided. And it is only, I think, in the last 20 years that we have seen universities begin to turn more completely to the communities that they are located in. We can give, and I'm sure you'll hear some examples here today, but looking, for example, and I'll just quickly close with three brief descriptions of examples. Of Penn, for example, in the 1990s and 1994, it had by that time surrounded itself as a campus with a kind of walled enclosure. When Judith Rodin became president, she decided it was really necessary, if the university was to flourish, that the neighborhood should flourish, and began a program of integrating not only its programs, but the life of the university and the life of the community, very successfully, reducing crime, improving housing, bringing cultural affairs, and creating within the programs of the university much more of a focus on the city and its urban problems. Much the same thing has been done at Yale under Rich Levin as president over the last period of time, and New Haven has benefited enormously from that engagement of the university. And a third example that, and there are hundreds that, or dozens that one could point to, and NYU is clearly one of them, a third example would be the role that Tulane has played in the rebuilding of New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina. That's a remarkable story, and in a description of that story, Scott Cowan, as the president of Tulane, made the comment that Tulane had been an international university. It was in New Orleans, but it was not of New Orleans. And Hurricane Katrina forced it to turn toward New Orleans and become a university of the city as well as in the city, the very motto of NYU here in New York City. I think the last 20 years have seen really universities begin to turn to their localities, to the cities in which they are embedded, and begin to have that kind of dialogue with those cities that has both improved the universities in the cities. I'm supposed to end with a question, so I will pose a question, John said. And that is that we're at a time when universities are in facing very, very severe hardships. And the question is that exchange, is the kind of relationship that has been developed between universities and cities going to redound to the benefit of the universities as well as it has to the cities? Clearly it has intellectually. It also, it seems to me, in the challenges that universities face with tremendous financial problems and the problems that the country faces, a serious question is how can cities contribute to the well-being and the life and the survival and advancement of the universities themselves. And with that, I'll close and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.